हेलो
मैडम,
सर। हाँ, यू जस्ट टॉक फॉर 2 मिनट्स सर, जस्ट विल चेक ऑडियो एंड क्लैरिटी, दैट्स ऑल।
ओके मैडम,
ओके सर।
हाय, गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल. दिस इज विजयराजन फ्रॉम मैक्स मेटिकुलस एकेडमी ऑफ एक्सलेंस. सो टुडे वी विल बी सीइंग एन वेबिनार ऑन हाउ ड्रोन्स एंड एक्सटेंडेड रियलिटी विल बी यूज्ड इन इंडस्ट्री 4.0 इन इंडस्ट्रीज सच एज मैन्युफैक्चरिंग, ऑटोमोबाइल and in other industries, how these two technologies will play a huge role. That we'll be seeing that in details.
ओके सर,
And as
ओके
well as
सर,
I,
थैंक यू सर।
yeah.
हाँ, थैंक यू सर,
Thank
वील स्टार्ट बाय 11 o'clock सर। ओके सर, थैंक यू,
Okay,
थैंक
madam.
यू। सर, यू मेक उमा मैम एज प्रेजेंटर नाउ, और आई विल मेक। ओके सर, जस्ट अ मिनट।
ओके मैम, माय सेल्फ सर।
The ventral view, that is the palm beach. Sorry, by mistake, it is an arthritic subject. So in the case of arthritic subjects, when you see, when you cluster it, the cluster one contains, I think, the yellow regions are get segmented, and the cluster three, and finally in cluster
Uma, shall we start, Uma? It's 11 o'clock.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, start, ma'am.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. I hope all are doing good. I welcome you all for this wonderful webinar on roles of drones and extended reality in Industry 4.0. I request Dr. Nalini Joseph, Vice Principal and HOD of EC Department, LILO Institute of Technology, to give the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Uma. Good morning, all the participants. On behalf of LILO Institute of Management, Administrator, Principal, we wholeheartedly welcome all the participants all over India. On behalf of you, we, the coordinators, welcome the speaker of today's session, Mr. K.R. Vijayarajan, founder of MAX, Meticulous Academy of Excellence, who is a young entrepreneur with enriched experience. Sir, we thank you for accepting our invitation and welcome to the webinar. The day is yours, sir. In this contest, I congratulate all the coordinators of this webinar, faculty members of ECE, and professional friends who made this happen, as well as the participants. Dear participants, once again, I welcome you all for this great webinar. Have a technical day. Thank you. Over to Uma.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request Mrs. Priya, Associate Professor, ECD, to introduce our speaker. Over to you, ma'am.
Good morning to one and all present here. I take immense pleasure in introducing today's resource person, Mr. K.R. Vijayarajan. He has 12 years of experience in IT and core domains. He worked in various IT sectors such as Accenture, Tech Mahindra. At present, he is the founder and CEO of MAX, Meticulous Academy of Excellence. He is a certified trainer for various modules such as Communication for Success and Effective Stakeholder Management. His area of interest are virtual or augmented reality, drones, 3D printing, web development, user experience, and web accessibility. His other interests are public speaking, and he is also a well-versed cinema player. We are happy to have him as a resource person. Welcome you, sir. Over to Uma Maheshwari, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Now the most awaited session of the day, let us dive into the world of drones. I request Mr. Vijayarajan to take us in that journey. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you, madam. Thanks for that warm introduction. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Nalini, madam, for this opportunity. I hope you all are able to hear my voice and see the screen, which has started sharing now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So good morning, everyone. Yeah, thank you, madam. Thank you, madam. So good morning, everyone. So today we'll be seeing how drones and extended reality will be used in Industry 4.0. So as we all know, due to COVID-19, we are all moving towards online learning, remote collaboration, and work from home thing. So at this point of time, drones and extended reality, such as virtual augmented reality and mixed reality, will be used more to help on this work from home, remote collaboration. We'll see how that can be done using these technologies. And I'll also share some videos of in drones, virtual and augmented reality, what we have done on this side. And if time permits, I'll also show a demo of how we do a project in virtual and augmented reality using Unity tool, Unity platform. So without further delay, so I'll get into the session. Yeah, first before we see more about how drones can be used, first we'll understand what is drone. As we all know, drone is known as unmanned aerial vehicle, UAVs, or UAS, unmanned aerial system, and it can be remotely controlled or fly autonomously also. through software control flight plans in them. So this is just a basic introduction of what drone or UAV is about. And in this slide, we'll see what are the different types of drones available in the market. So these are the different types of drones categorized based on the weight of the drone. So one is the nano drones, which is 250 or less than 250 grams. This categorization is done by our Indian government. DGCA has categorized these types of I think can someone mute? Thank you.
Yes, sir, we'll do it, sir.
Yeah, thank you, madam. Yeah, nano drone is which is 250 gram or less than 250 gram. Micro drone is up to 2 kgs, and small, medium, and large, depending upon the weight of the drone and how much it can the payload it can carry. Government, our Indian government has categorized these drones into different types. So only nano drones, which is equal or less than 250 grams drone. Any people who want to try out how to fly a drone, or they want to learn about drone, that we can fly and test it without informing the government or without informing your nearest police station. But other categories of drones which are listed, other types of drones, we need approval from the government or approval from the local police authority in order to fly these drones. So these are some of the regulations we have in place in India. So because just like we use more smartphones, we can't use drones, because drones are though there are many good things we can do with drones, but there are also many hazardous and dangerous things also we can do with a drone. We can use it for spying, or we can do any things which is not possible with other things. It can be done easily with drones. So that's why government is more restricted towards opening this drone sector as far as our India is concerned. And that is also one of the reason why we are very, very slowly moving towards this drone industry compared to China, who has already as we all know, all Chinese drones only we are using. Whatever the drones we see in the marriage halls and the drones we see everywhere, most of them are Chinese made drones only. So that's because the Indian government has not opened up the market so much by considering the security aspect into it. So that's why they have categorized into these different types. Yeah. So now we'll see how these drones will be used in the Industry 4.0 or some of the industries which I have listed in the current slide. So first is on mining and construction. So mining and construction, for measuring the stockpile management of how much stock is there. So earlier, manually people have to go and check how much is available in that place. So now with the help of drones, they can just fly the drone, and with specialized sensors like LIDAR scanners. So LIDAR is light detection and ranging sensors are there. So with that, they'll be able to get how much stockpile is there and what are the areas they want to survey. With that LIDAR added drones, they'll be able to do it. So this is widely used in mining and construction things. And secondly, on the for solar panel and oil fields inspection. So for the large solar panel fields and all, every now and then or every few months, they need to inspect those huge solar panels to make sure everything, all the solar panels are working. So the problem with solar panels is if any one of the solar cell is not working, it will damage the whole solar panel itself. So that's why they do quality check every now and then. So that is also a tedious process, manually doing the solar panel checking, checking the solar panels. But with drones, they can easily scan the whole solar panel and detect for any issues in the solar cell. For example, if there is any issue in the solar cell, if you are using infrared enabled drones, with that infrared enabled drones, that particular solar cell alone will detect a different color and shown in the while we 3D map the captured data. So by that way, they'll be able to identify that particular solar panel or the solar cell alone is being not in good shape. Then they will rectify that issue. So this saves a huge amount of money for the solar panel and even for oil fields inspection also, by using by employing drones instead of manually the persons going and checking or checking that site. And thirdly, on surveillance, for a surveillance purpose also, drones are used most. And going forward also, it will be used, we'll be using more drones for a surveillance purpose. And the next thing on 3D mapping. So 3D mapping is, for example, there are acres of land, and all those acres of land, we are capturing the aerial footage using drones, and that aerial footage will be converted into 3D mapping data, such as digital elevation models or digital terrain models. So that is what is the 3D mapping is all about. This 3D mapping will be used more, and so people who are trying to enter into drone industry or who are looking for job in drones, there are two things. One is on the hardware side and the software side. Hardware side is being a drone pilot or building your own drone and getting the data out of it by flying the drone. That is on the hardware side. On the software side is like doing this 3D mapping. So converting that aerial footage data into an digital elevation model or orthomosaic thing. So that is on the 3D mapping side. So people can get job opportunities on both this hardware and software side as well. And the other area is for delivery. So so we all know we have been using Zomato and Swiggy for food delivery. We have seen, so they are coming to our home and giving the food which we order. So going forward for delivery, we might see drones delivering the foods and drones delivering medical supplies in places which people will not be able to go easily. So even in US, a postal company has got the approval of US government to deliver for posts and medical supplies for people living in remote areas. So at the at that places, manually people will not be able to go easily, but with drones they can easily attach the medical, the emergency medical supplies or the food delivery or any other item into it, into the drone, and just by giving the latitude and longitude coordinates, it will fly to that area and drop that particular thing to them. So just think, if it is an emergency medical thing, so within minutes or within within minutes it will fly and it can drop that emergency medical thing, which can easily save that particular person's life who is looking for that medicine. So even if we are traveling and if a person is giving that, it is going to take more time due to traffic and other things in place. Considering these things, many countries are allowing drones to delivery, drones for delivering emergency medical supplies or emergency any other things, which will take more time if they are going in the normal traffic or the normal route. So even our Indian government has proposed in our drone regulations 2.0. It has said they are planning to give drone hotspots between hospitals to hospitals. So for example, in Chennai, there are two hospitals, and in one hospital, there's a need for heart transplantation or some other emergency medical thing. And that has to be transported to the next hospital, so which is a few kilometers away. Even if you are going in traffic, we all know how bad the traffic is. And every second is precious for the person who is waiting for that medical supply to arrive. So at that point of time, if you're having drones for delivering from one hospital to the another hospital, just the drone can transport easily that emergency medical supply. Within minutes, it can transport it, and safely also. So as long as there is no bad weather, so there's not huge wind or there's no rainfall, if the sky is clear, the drones can easily deliver. So these areas for last mile connectivity, drones will be used more. And not only just for the healthcare, for delivering medical supplies, even a couple of companies in India also have got approval for delivering food and other things via drone. So everything is in a testing phase. Once everything is commercialized, we'll see drones delivery as a common thing going forward. And the other thing is agricopters are agri drones. So so for spraying, drone sprayers are used in agricultural fields. So this is not just in agriculture. Even we have seen this during last month, I think, in Chennai, many places they have used for spraying disinfectant, they have used these type of drones. So these type of drones are made for spraying purpose in agriculture fields, but for using it as disinfectant to reduce the corona spread also, we have seen in places like Chennai, even Chennai Corporation has used these type of drones. So this type of drones is more used in agriculture area. So even the problem with agriculture is shortage of labor is the huge issue with in farming and agriculture. So with drones, agriculture, the land owner itself, he can easily spray his land using the sprayer drone. So with a minimal knowledge itself, once he is able to fly this drone, so he can easily spray the disinfectant or pesticides using this agricopters or sprayer drones. So, and it has comes with multiple variants like 5 kgs, 10 kgs and 20 kgs of liquids. It can, the payloads it can carry and spray it over a large area of land. So even I got many requirements for for doing agricultural drones, and not just in Chennai or any other urban city. I get requirements from many southern part of Tamil Nadu and other places also for this agri drones and sprayer drones. So that much a need is there for the opportunities are there in the drone sector, not just in mining or any other industry. Even in agriculture also, there is a huge scope for drones. So spraying drones is just one part of how it can be used in agriculture. And another thing is precision farming is one where drones can be used in agriculture. For example, you are having acres of land, and with the precision farming, you will be able to identify if there is any other the particular area alone is affected by weeds or it is affected due to any other reason. So that thing alone you will be able to monitor using the drones, and that area alone you can make sure that problem is not spreading to other areas in your farm. So this precision farming also is possible with drones. So, but this precision farming is not yet come in India. So far in India, many farmers and agriculturalists are using sprayer drones. But in Western countries, along with this sprayer drones, they're also going for precision farming as well. So in these areas also, drones will be used more. And finally, on the defense side, so defense side, drone swarm, there's a new concept called drone swarm. So as you could see from the current picture in the slide, so there are a group of drones flying. So this what this group of drones will fly, and they'll accomplish a target. So so gone are the days where countries use nuclear weapons or other ammunitions and arsenals to attack another country. So, but everything is possible with the small miniature drones itself. So for just imagine 100 drones are entering the neighbor, the border, and attacking them. So that will damage, that will cause more damage than missile or any other kind of attack in the defense of the border area, because drones are that much powerful and dangerous as well. So how this drone swarm work is, everything works autonomously. So whatever the coordinates or the target it is given, so it will go and hit the target, and it will achieve the target and come back. So even last year, I think last year September or around that time, we all heard Saudi oil fields were attacked by drones and missiles. So everything were from other countries, the drones and missiles came and they attacked the oil field. And the another thing to notice, precisely they have attacked, so not just they attacked the oil field and came, and they just attacked the target exactly what they have, what the intruders have set. So that much powerful the drones are. And another advantage and disadvantage also is, so it is hard to track or hard to catch in the radar. So if there is a missile attack or any other attack which is coming from a neighboring country, so these radars and sensors will be able to track them and will be able to mitigate the risks. But if there is a huge drone swarm attacks, if there are 100 or 200 drones coming at a attacking the place, it is hard to track using the sophisticated radars in place. So that much dangerous these drone swarm attacks are, and many countries have moved from using missiles to attack to drones for spying and drone swarms for attacking the neighbors and coming back. So this is one of the areas where drones will be used more, and all those will be in autonomously they work, and they're attacking that target. So these are some of the areas where drones will be used more. So, and this slide is about how flight path we can set. So far we have seen how in various areas drones can be used. So for example, if you want to fly a drone, just for example, for a kilometers or a few kilometers of area, you need to take that aerial data from your drone. So that we do it using something called flight path, using softwares like open source softwares like Mission Planner is there. So this one is an example of the image is an example of Mission Planner software, wherein we just set the path, which areas that drone or the UAV need to fly. That will everything will be setting it in the software itself. Then after that only we just fly the drone. So after we set that, in that particular path only the drone will fly. Everything after that it is autonomous. So once we set the path and we fly the drone, then after that everything it will be going in autonomous way. But before that, this is how we set the path and fly the drone. Then with according to the path set in that software, it will fly and capture the data. So it will take images or videos, whatever we have set it in the tool. That images, we will converting it into 3D mapping data. So according to the requirement from the client, either into a digital elevation model or a terrain model. So depending upon the requirement, that images, whatever, for example, if it is covering kilometers of area, it will take thousands of images during that flight. So those thousands of images will be converted into the 3D mapping data using softwares like Pix4D, Drone Deploy. So there are many of the softwares which that is on the software side, which I said. So this will be coming on the hardware side, flying the drone, and on the software side, the 3D mapping of the data. So before we get into drone sector or how it can be used, we should also know about the drone policy in place in India. So because flying a drone outside without informing the police station or without informing the DGCA website is an offense. So we will be caught if you are flying a drone without any approval. So first thing is DGCA website. They have for drones, they have an exclusive website where with in which you can you should get, if you get the drone pilot license, you should let them know that you got the license, and also you should register your drone as well. So for example, just like we do registration for our vehicles which we buy, same way your drones also needs to be registered, and you'll be given a unique number for each drone, and as well as for as a drone pilot, you'll also be given a drone pilot license as well. So this needs to be mandatorily done if you are trying to become a drone pilot or if you are owning a drone as well. And the second thing is NPNT is no permission, no takeoff. So without permission, you're not able to fly a drone. So only the nano drones, which I was explaining in the previous slide. So if it is less, if it is up to 250 grams, no need of approval. So, but with 250 grams, you'll not be able to do much. So if that wind is so strong, that small drone will also go away with the wind. So 250 gram drones will not you'll not be able to achieve much. But if it is more than 250 grams, you need to get approval from the nearest police station and saying that for these purpose only you use, and then only you need to fly the drones. And nano drones, I explained this 250, it's approval is not needed. And 5 kilometers is like whatever the secured areas like airport or any other religious sites. So within the 5 kilometer perimeter of that area, you'll not be allowed to fly. And the other thing is, you will not be allowed to fly beyond visual line of sight. So only within your visual line of sight only we'll be able to fly. For example, if I am flying my drone for 5 or 6 kilometers beyond my visual line of sight, that is also not allowed in India. Until and unless you get a permission to do that for surveying or other purpose, if you have approvals, you can. But generally, there is no policy on that. So these are the drone policies which we need to know. And government is also updating the policy every now and then. So earlier they had drone policy 1.0 was there. Then 2.0 came up, wherein they encouraged local manufacturers to manufacture drones and rather than importing from China. And there are things happening from our side, Indian side also, but moving at a slower pace compared to China and other Western countries. So now I'll show some videos on drones. Just give me a minute. I'll stop this share and play that video. Just give me a minute. Yeah, this is a video of how they fly the drone, and that data is converted into the 3D mapping data, which I said the digital elevation and digital terrain model. How that is done, this is a sample video. I'll just play this video now. So this, I just paused the video. This is how they do that 3D mapping and other things. After they capture that aerial footage, they'll convert them into 3D mapping data. That is an example video of how the drone aerial footage is taken and converted into the 3D mapping data. So that is for the normal quadcopters or a drone which we see that in marriage halls and other areas. But with this normal quadcopters or drones, we'll be able to fly only for 20 or 30 minutes because the battery is very time is limited. If you are covering a large area, we'll go for a fixed wing drone. So I'll just show you a video of how that fixed wing drones operate. Just give me a minute. I'm just playing a video. So whatever is my the video of my friend. He is working as a drone pilot currently. So he is holding the fixed wing drone in his hand, as you can see from the past video. So this fixed wing drone will have long duration. So for example, 1 hour, even 1 hour and 1.5 hours, it can survey the land. Whereas this normal quadcopter drones can fly only for 20 or 30 minutes. So this is how we just fly that drone after setting the flight path in the mission planner thing, which I have shown in the slide. I'll just run this video now. So I'll just run this video for the interest of time. Yeah. So these type of fixed wing drones will have long duration compared to this normal quadcopter things which we see normally everywhere. So just give me a minute, I'll go back to the presentation. Just a minute, I'll just give me a minute. Yeah, there are many questions on the drones side. So I'll answer all those questions after I finish the whole session. So please keep posting if you have any questions. So that is on the drone side. So so drones have huge opportunities, not just in one area. As I said, even in agriculture, there is a huge scope for drones, and people can get into the hardware area. They can be a drone pilot, and on the software side, they can do this 3D mapping of the aerial footage and the data which is collected to the through the drone. So two areas, there are a lot of opportunities are there, and it's a good time to get into the drones as well. And if you're really passionate about drones, so what I would suggest is to learn how to build a drone by yourself, just a simple quadcopter. So you can learn with the online videos itself, that you try and operate, fly that, then you can get into the other fixed wing drones and the other softwares into it. Yeah, so now so we'll go to the next section, the extended reality. So extended reality is the combination of virtual, augmented, and mixed reality is what extended reality, which we collectively call. So first we'll see what is virtual reality. So virtual reality is something which gives us an immersive experience. So for example, if you wear a virtual reality head mounted device and view that application, you feel like as if you are inside that particular world or the particular virtual world. So that immersive experience only virtual reality will offer. Yeah, in this slide we'll see what are the types of VR devices. So these are some of the popular VR devices. HTC Vive, Oculus Rift, Oculus Go, Oculus Quest are the popular VR devices with which we can immerse ourselves into that VR world and see that thing. And the last one is the haptic gloves. So haptic gloves is not a head mounted device, it's a gloves used in hands for giving touch or touch feedback. So how that works, I will discuss that in the coming slide. So how this haptic gloves works is, so once you wear the virtual reality headset and view that application, I said you'll be able to visualize, or you feel like as if you are inside that particular world. So you are able to visualize with head mounted device. So with this haptic gloves does is, with haptic gloves you will be feel that environment itself. For example, you are touching an object in virtual reality, you'll be able to feel how that object is, how hard, or what is the shape of the object, or how rigid of that object is with this haptic gloves. This haptic gloves will give the vibration, or it'll give that feel of how by touching that object in a virtual world itself. For example, if you are touching the object in a physical world, the same thing can be replicated in a virtual world with this haptic gloves. So for example, yeah, in this current slide you could see a person is holding an virtual object. the same object, for example, what is the shape of the object, or what is the how hard or soft that object is, everything can be given using haptic gloves. What is the advantage of using haptic gloves with the virtual reality devices? With the virtual reality head mount device, you are able to visualize. With the haptic gloves, you are able to touch and feel. So when you are combining these two sensors, touch and visualization, you are sending more information to the brain for processing. So for example, in a manufacturing setup, for example, in a manufacturing industry, you are giving a training to an employee on how to operate a machinery in virtual reality with haptic gloves. So once he wears that device, he'll be able to see how that machinery is, and with haptic gloves, he'll be operate that machinery. For example, he's operating that machinery in virtual reality. If he changes the gear, or if he's doing some other operations in the machinery, how hard or how rigid that machinery is, he'll be able to feel as well. So once after he is given a real task, he'll be able to do that better, since he has already visualized and has also felt how that machinery would work like in virtual world itself with haptic gloves and head mounted device. So these are advantage of using haptic gloves. So haptic gloves can be not only just manufacturing and healthcare and another sector also, haptic gloves will be used more along with virtual reality head mounted device. Yeah, now we'll see what is augmented reality. You have seen what is virtual reality, augmented reality. We'll see what is AR or augmented reality is. Augmented reality is something which adds an digital overlay or a 3D world in your physical world, is what augmented reality is all about. So to explain it more simply, as you could see from the current picture in the slide, a book is there, and a person is scanning that book using his augmented reality application in his tablet. After he scans that particular image, the heart image in the book, he's getting that 3D model of the heart inside his application, augmented reality application. And since the mobile or the tablet camera is on, he feels that that particular 3D model is happening in his real environment. So that is what augmented reality is all about. So here, wherein he is interacting with the digital world, that 3D model in this real world is AR or augmented reality is about. So that is the advantage of augmented reality over virtual reality as well. And coming to mixed reality, so we have seen what is virtual and augmented realities. Now we'll quickly see what is mixed reality is also about. Mixed reality is merging of real and virtual world, and where both real and virtual world coexist and interact with each other is what is called mixed reality. So as you could see from the picture in this slide, so in that slide, I am there in that slide, along with an chimpanzee is also there in the slide. It feels like we both are interacting with each other. So this is what is called mixed reality. So both real and virtual world are merged, and both are in interacting with each other is called mixed reality. So just a combination of real and virtual world. So how it is done is, it's an extension of what augmented reality is only, is shown as mixed reality. I'll show a video if time permits how it is done. I'll discuss in later part of the session. But this is what mixed reality is about. So virtual reality is, we feel like we are inside that 3D world is virtual reality. Augmented reality is 3D world will interact in our world, physical world is augmented reality. Mixed reality is, it's a combination of both physical and real world, where both interact with each other is mixed reality. Yeah. So now we'll see what are the differences between virtual and augmented reality. You've seen the definition, now we'll see the key differences. So first is virtual reality is totally immersive environment. So as I said, once you wear that VR device, you feel like you are teleported, or you are completely into that virtual world. And another, the second thing is, your senses are under control of the system and not under control of the one who is viewing. So since you are, after you wear that VR device, you'll completely unaware of what is going around you in the real world. So even if someone comes near you, something is happening around in a real world, will not be aware of, since you will be immersed in the virtual world. So that is also a disadvantage with virtual reality. So though immersiveness is the biggest selling point in virtual reality, so this not being aware of what is going around in the real world is a little disadvantage with the virtual reality. And coming to augmented reality, your system augments the real world scene. So it just augments means it just elevates your real world scene with this digital or the 3D objects is what augmented reality. And here the key benefit is user maintains a sense of presence in real world. So whereas compared to the virtual reality, in augmented reality, you'll be able to interact with the digital or the 3D world, but at the same time you'll also be aware of what is going around you in the real world, is what's a huge advantage of augmented reality. So though virtual reality will be used in areas like training and remote collaboration, but in other areas augmented reality will have an edge over virtual reality due to this scenario of how they can maintain a sense of presence in the real world. Yeah, now we'll see how this social VR concept works. So we all know about social media, social networking, and in recent times we are hearing about social distancing. And there's a new thing coming up in virtual reality, which is called social VR or social virtual reality. So how the social virtual reality works is, for example, as you could see from the two pictures in the slide, so there are 3D avatars for each unique users. So each unique user will be having their own unique 3D avatars, and they'll be interacting with themselves using that 3D avatar. So for example, if I'm wearing a VR device, and I'll be entering that virtual environment or the virtual world. So, and I'll be having my own unique 3D avatar. And if you are entering that virtual world, you will be having your unique avatar, and we both will be interacting with each other with this unique 3D avatars. So the benefit out of it is, for example, normally in an office or in a place where people work, they discuss and brainstorm the ideas by interacting with each other. So that interaction is nowadays not possible due to the social distancing and other things in place, which also we are working from home more often than ever. So due to that, that team's closeness or that team rapport is missing. But with the social VR, that the same team closeness and rapport can be brought in using the social VR, wherein all those team members can interact with each other using that 3D avatars, which you are seeing now. And they'll be able to interact and play and socialize with friends as they would do in a physical real world. Same thing can be done remotely also using this social virtual reality concept. It's not just for playing and socializing, for training, for educating, and also for remote collaboration or team meetings. Everything can happen with this social VR as well. So we'll see how this works in the video after I finish these slides. So now quickly, this is a demo of how web-based virtual reality works. So if anyone can scan this QR code and see that in their website, you can see how that page looks, or that web-based virtual reality looks. So I'll just give 1 or 2 minutes. So probably any participants can scan this and see that web-based virtual reality in their mobile phones, and then we'll discuss about it. So before, while you are scanning this QR code, I'll also talk about this web VR. In virtual or augmented reality, there are two things can be done. So in virtual reality, we can create applications for VR head-mounted device, just like HTC Vive or Oculus Quest. So for those devices, we create applications. That's a different thing. And for web-based, whatever the websites or the browsers which we use, browser-based and web-based virtual reality environments also can be done using this web VR. So that is what is about this QR code is about. Once you scan this QR code, it just opens a web page. You'll be able to 360 degree, you'll be able to move and see that page which is not possible in a normal web page. So that's the difference between a normal web page and a VR based web page. If anyone could can anyone confirm whether they have seen this this QR code?
Sir, we have seen. I have seen as organizer, I have seen.
Okay, madam. Yeah, thank you, madam. In this page,
also, opening,
yeah, madam. Even using mouse, we can scroll and see this, see that scene in that web page in a 360-degree view. So, yeah, in a normal web page which we create using HTML, JavaScript, or other tools, we'll not be able to see that in this holistic 360-degree view. But with web-based VR, virtual reality-based pages, this 360 or holistic view is possible. So that is on the, if you want to experience virtual reality using web-based, this is the option. And if you want to really experience on immerse yourselves only by using virtual reality head-mounted device only, you'll be able to have a immersive experience. So that is the differences between these two. So how virtual reality can be used in Industry 4.0 is, so one is on that for training, so for manufacturing industries, for training the employees on how to operate a machinery or how to the process about their system, everything, the training can be given in a virtual reality. So wherein people who are learning will immerse themselves and learn, and in real time they'll do it much better by giving this virtual reality training. And in healthcare also, for training the surgeons on how to operate a patient, so virtual reality trainings that can be given. And the other area for remote collaboration, for the social VR which I've discussed, in that area also, so virtual reality will be used more, and many companies are moving towards that only, how to make the team collaborate effectively by sitting at the comfort of their home. So that is also one of the area where virtual reality will be used. Okay, I'll show some videos on virtual reality before I get into this augmented reality. Just I'll stop this presentation and run the video. Just wait a minute. Yeah, I'm just sharing the screen. Yeah, started sharing. Yeah, this is a video of how this virtual reality meetings or remote collaboration works. So I'll just play that video and discuss about it. Meetings or remote collaboration works. I'll just play that. Yeah, this is an example of how this virtual reality meetings would happen. As you could see, the team is discussing with each other using the 3D avatars. So normally how they would discuss in the real office environment, the same thing is simulated in a virtual reality. So in virtual reality environment also, the office setup is there. And they are also interacting with one another using that unique 3D avatars. By this way, team collaboration will be more, even though they work remotely as well. So quickly, I'll play one more video on virtual reality. So how this VR is used in healthcare, and then I'll get back to the presentation. Okay.
Good. Place four more staples. Close off the laceration.
Yeah, as an example of how VR can be used in healthcare for training the surgeons. So as you all saw in this video, the surgeons are getting trained in virtual reality by wearing this VR device. So now I'll just run back to the presentation. Just give me a minute. I'll open the slides. Yeah, so far we have discussed how virtual reality can be used in industries, and we saw a few videos about that as well. And now we'll talk about the another important thing, which is in, not audible. Just a minute. Madam, is my voice audible?
Yes, sir. Your voice is audible, sir.
Okay, madam. Yeah, thank you, madam. Thank you. So now we'll quickly see
how video alone. Yeah. Video audio is not coming, sir, but your voice alone is coming.
Okay, madam. I'll check that, madam. Okay. So when I play the next video. Yeah, thank you, madam. So in augmented reality, there are two things in augmented reality. One is creating augmented reality mobile applications or augmented reality apps, which we do. And the other thing is augmented reality glasses. So as you would see from the current slide, so these are the different augmented reality and smart glasses available in the market. The first one is HoloLens from Microsoft, and the third one is from Google, and others are from the other players from the augmented reality space. So these augmented reality glasses are used for multiple purposes. For example, in manufacturing, it is used. For example, if in a manufacturing setup, if a person wears that glass and works on that, and if he comes up with any issues, and if he encounters any issue, he can get that rectified by this augmented reality glass itself. So if he is facing an issue, he can get that things on how to fix that issue. In his augmented reality glass frame itself, he'll be able to get information on how to fix. And he'll also be able to communicate with the other person also using this augmented reality glass also. By that day, he'll be able to fix that issue quickly, and production also will not stopped. And same way in other areas also, for consumers also, just the fourth image in the slide is, you could see the Focals by North, the fourth image in the slide. So this one looks like a normal reading glass, but I could see some information is given in that augmented reality glass frame. Some weather information or about the place, or some other reviews about a place which we are going. So that can be displayed in that augmented reality glass itself. So that benefit of this thing is, as I said, about explaining about augmented reality, it is like, user maintains a sense of presence in the real world also. Though they are getting that information in that augmented reality glass frame, they are completely aware of what is going around in the real world as well. So it is like best of both worlds for them. So that is why it's a more advantageous than virtual reality. So it's, it can be used in consumers and as well as for the industries on manufacturing, healthcare, and other areas as well. Yeah, so the previous slide, we talked about how augmented reality or smart glasses can be used. This one is like how augmented reality applications can be used to benefit the customers who are using that. For example, in this slide, for troubleshooting a particular thing, augmented reality application can be used. So for servicing customers via augmented reality. So for example, as you could see from the picture, so a network router kind of thing is there. If in a normal scenario, if that issue comes up, we will normally call the customer service, and they will come to the place and fix that issue. So that's what the normal process is. But with augmented reality, the people can itself, they themselves can fix the issue without any external guidance. So there is no need of people traveling to the place and fix the issues, and no need of waiting time also. There is no need of to wait for more time. This augmented reality application itself will guide you on how to fix that issue. As you could see from the image, so there's a yellow circle is given in that augmented reality that tablet application. That yellow circle is the one, probably the problem area which the user has to fix or change the wire for make that thing to work. So the person, that yellow thing or the thing, the virtual hand you are seeing inside the thing, is the one who is connected remotely and guiding the user using this augmented reality application. So by this way also, it does hugely, augmented reality will help the people for servicing and other things. And with this corona and this COVID-19 thing, we are not able to travel around. At this time, this via augmented reality, these issues can be fixed. So this is one area many industries and many companies are trying to use augmented reality for fixing or troubleshooting the issues. Yeah. So far I have talked about virtual and augmented reality as a standalone technology and how it can be used in various industries. But augmented reality's full potential can be unleashed only when augmented reality is combined with internet other technologies like IoT, AI, cloud computing, and so on. That's when more industries will use augmented reality. So as you could see from the current picture in the slide, a person is inside a warehouse and is scanning the warehouse with the augmented reality application in his tablet. After he scans that warehouse, he is getting some real-time value of the warehouse. For example, 5 item remaining, 80% task, and some color-coded values and arrow marks are given. So this 5 item remaining could be the number of items remaining in the particular compartment or shelf. And by knowing this, he'll be able to work on that particular compartment alone and make sure there are more items or are sufficient items remaining are available. So if he's not using this augmented reality thing, he needs to check manually in the warehouse how many items are there or what are the things in place or not, which is a time tedious process and it'll take not be able to do more tasks as well. But with this, getting real-time data and showing it in augmented reality, he'll be able to do more tasks in less time. So with IoT sensors, we can get the values. So that values, we can populate that in augmented reality, using augmented reality as a front end and show it. So only when augmented reality is combined with other technologies like IoT, AI, or cloud computing, many possibilities are there and many industries also will use augmented reality. And industries, especially such as manufacturing and automobile, are more using these type of things only, how to combine augmented reality with IoT to get real-time value and display it in AR. Yeah. So before I get into the videos, I'll quickly discuss about the development tools. If anyone is interested to get into virtual and augmented reality field, or if you want to work or develop apps on that, these are the popular tools. So tools are Unity and Unreal. So Unity and Unreal are game engines for creating both virtual and augmented reality applications. And third and fourth, Vuforia and Wikitude are marker-based or image-based things. For example, if I scan the particular image, my augmented reality application should work. So for that, we use Vuforia and Wikitude. And AR Core and AR Kit are SDKs for Android and iOS. Just like we create mobile apps for Android and iOS separately, we create augmented reality mobile apps for Android using AR Core and augmented reality mobile apps for iOS using AR Kit. So these are the different tools which is available to create virtual and augmented reality apps. So we really want to learn everything about, you can easily download Unity tool. So it's a free version is also available. So with that, you can just try creating simple apps and then go forward and create any complex VR and virtual augmented reality apps. So I think some disturbance can, yeah, thank you. So now we'll run some videos on augmented reality. Just give me a minute. I'll stop this presentation and share the video. Thank you. Yeah, this one is an example of how augmented reality glasses can be used for day-to-day purpose. So I'll just run this video and then discuss about it.
Use blown conductive speakers transmitted through vibration. Send directly to your inner ear, only you.
Hi, Judy. Let's get today started.
Bone conduction lets you stay aware of your surroundings, even as you enjoy your music. View is built for people who use prescription glasses, sunglasses, and even style frames. At an ultra-light 28 grams, it won't weigh you down. View talks to your phone via Bluetooth. With the app, you can perform a range of different tasks without checking your phone, like take a call, hands-free.
You have a call from Leslie.
Hey, Leslie, what's going on?
Get directions?
In 200 feet, turn left on 10th Street.
Or control your music. View is designed for work and play.
Yeah, so as you all saw in this video, what are the things which we do normally with smartphones, like checking time, speaking to the friend, or taking pictures, or playing music, or navigation using GPS. Everything is possible with augmented reality glasses also. Soon we'll be seeing people using this and you will not be able to differentiate whether they are wearing a normal power glass or a reading glass or an augmented reality glass. So that is how this augmented reality has scope. And not just on consumers and not industry also, augmented reality has more scope compared to virtual reality. So I'll play video of quickly video of what we have done. Just a minute. Yeah, just. So this is an idea of what we have done for one of our manufacturing client. So this is an example of a heavy vehicle engine, and the requirement was to make the users understand easily about the heavy vehicle engine and its part. So in this example, if they click on explode button, so they'll be able to see the different engine parts in detail, and by that the user would understand easily about that particular heavy vehicle engine, rather than studying them in a PowerPoint presentation or in any other way. By providing them as an augmented reality application is more useful and also easy for them to make them understand. I'll play that video now.
Sir, no audio for this?
Yeah, madam. This one doesn't has audio, madam.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah, that was an just pause that. Yeah, that was an example of augmented reality application we did for one of our client. And again, this another video of a different air application we did. So this one is an example of an injector assembly model and different parts of injector assembly. By clicking the different buttons in that air application, users will be able to understand easily in detail. So I'll just play that video quickly and then go to the demo and the question and answer session. So every details about that injector assembly, people will be able to understand easily by giving them as an augmented reality application. Yeah, in the interest of time, I'll just pause this video. And so just give me a minute. I'll open that Unity tool. So meanwhile, if you have any questions, please post that. So I'll take a minute to open that demo. So meanwhile, I'll answer the questions. So before still that Unity tool is getting loaded. Yeah, I've stopped sharing the video, so I'll open that demo tool now. Just please wait for a minute. Yeah, there was a question from SP Priya. How VR can be implemented to help the doctors in this current situation of COVID? A good question. So how VR can be implemented is they already implemented in UK. So they've used Microsoft HoloLens device. So by wearing that device, that doctor will see that patient. So once he goes to go near that patient, whatever the patient's history or what the condition of the patient, everything will be displayed to him in that HoloLens glass itself, in that frame itself. So he'll be able, he'll not be using his hands to see the case or to see the X-ray report or any other thing. So he, every details, he'll be able to see that in that Microsoft HoloLens device which the doctor is wearing. And another thing is, without HoloLens, a couple of doctors needs to go and check. But with HoloLens, a single doctor alone can go into that particular, into that, see that particular patient, and other doctors can remotely guide that doctor who is already inside that ward, and they will be guiding them how to, what to do, and what are the things he needs to make sure that patient is cured. So because of that, two things. One is the doctor who is in is not using his hands, so he's hands-free. And he is not risking his life, so by using his hands without getting this virus. And the other thing is, the other doctors are guiding him, so other doctors are also safely sitting at a remote place and guiding the doctor who is in remotely with this Microsoft HoloLens, which is also a mixed reality headset, just like HTC Vive and others. So in this way, virtual reality can be used for at this COVID-19 situation. Yeah, just a minute. I think the Unity tool has I just opened the Unity tool. I'll start sharing that screen. Yeah, I've just started sharing the screen now. So this is the tool which we use to create most of our virtual and augmented reality application. I think all are able to see the screen now.
Yes, sir. Screen is visible.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Okay, madam. Yeah, this tool only we use for creating VR and AR applications. So in this demo, what I have done is I have imported a 3D model of a car, and image target, I have set my company logo as the image target. And once I run the application, only if I show that particular image target, which I set, that 3D model will appear. For any other image, that application will not work. So I'll just run this now and show that demo. Just wait a minute. It will take some time since a 3D file is heavy.
There are many questions have come. You will answer the questions at the end, sir.
Okay, madam, I'll just finish this demo and
okay.
Sir, then, madam. Yeah, I think you are able to see the screen. So I'm just running that application. Now I'm showing a different picture. So when I show a different picture, that 3D model will not appear. Now I'll show the my company logo, which I set as the image target. So now that 3D model will work. So as you all could see. So, and I am also, I've also given a button function for rotating. So if I click that button, so I'll be able to rotate and see that model as well. And if I take that image away, that application will not work. So this is an example of how we create, this is an example of augmented reality application using Unity and Euphoria. So now I'll just go back to the presentation. Just give me a minute. I'll stop sharing this. Again, sharing the presentation. So development tools we have seen, we saw, and this demo also we just saw using Unity tool, how to that augmented reality application works using Unity and Euphoria tool. So now we'll get into the question and answer session, madam. So shall we get into a Q&A, madam?
Yes, sir. Thanks for wonderful
session,
sir.
Yeah, thank you, madam.
It was very informative and thank you. Now we have now we have come to question section. I will hand it over to Priya ma'am.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon. The first question is how much height can these delivery drone can fly?
Yeah, madam, I'll answer your voice. Your echo is there. Will
hello,
speak, madam. Yes, madam. Now,
Priya, ma'am. Yeah, so the
sir,
question is Purna Santosh. Okay, so he has asked many questions. He or she, how much height can this delivery drones can fly?
Yeah.
What are the types which is the best? What are the types of drones which is the best, and if the air traffic will be more, how it can be handled?
Yeah, madam, I'll answer all those three questions, madam.
Okay.
Thanks for asking that good questions. So first is height is 400 feet is the height limit which most countries operate. So only up to 400 feet is the allowable limit. So beyond that, if it is delivery drones, they'll have more than 400 feet they can fly, but normal flying limit is from the ground level till 400 feet. But drone can fly above 2000 feet also, it can fly. 400 feet is the limit. And the second thing is type of drones. For delivery, I think there's some echo. So others can please mute it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you, madam. For delivery, not this normal quadcopters which we see in generally, though those drones will not be used. Fixed wing drones will be used for delivery purpose. And the last question is about what is the last question is about, madam? There was three questions.
If the air traffic is more, how it can be handled?
Yeah. So for air traffic is more, detection, collision, and avoidance technique these drones will be having. So all these drones, even the DJI drones which you see, they also have this detection, collision and avoiding. They're facing any obstacle in front of them, they'll just bypass that obstacle and travel. So by using this detection, collision and avoidance technique, even though there is huge air traffic, they will not hit each other. They just avoid and fly. Yeah, madam.
Okay, sir. Next question is from Ms. Sharmi. What should be the minimum spacing between the drones when a group of drones fly?
Okay. Fine, madam. So when group of drones fly, they also everything works autonomously. They set the path, and every drones will have sensors attached to them. With that, they'll be having some exact distance. I'm not sure, but there'll be at least 50-100 feet distance between each drone will be there.
Okay, sir. Next question from Mr. Rajesh Kumar.
Yeah, madam.
How much range should be used to operate for attacking? What is the frequency band of drone?
What is the first one, madam? How much?
How much range should be used to be operated for attacking?
Okay.
What is the frequency band of drone?
Yeah, for defense purpose, they use high altitude and medium altitude range UAVs, which can fly for above 10,000 or 20,000 feet, and for hours together, for example, for 10 or 20 hours together also, it will fly. Those type of UAVs, fixed wing UAVs only they use. And band with this, mostly drones operate on 2.8 gigahertz. So that bandwidth only they'll use normally. Radio frequency band. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Then the next question is from Subhadip Sanyasi. What are the best drone platforms for research?
Research, they should first say that they should start building a normal quadcopter, and then they should go for how to build a fixed wing drone, and then how to work on vertical takeoff and landing drones. By this way, they will gradually understand the whole concept of drones. So this is the right approach for doing a drone research, madam.
Okay, sir. The next question is from Shiva Dilip. What is the average height by drones? Average height flight?
Height 400. Average is 400 feet only. It's allowed limit, madam. But it can fly above that also. It can fly above 1,000, 2,000 feet also. These DJI drones can fly. But the normal allowable limit is 400 feet from the ground level.
Okay, sir. The next question is from Dimble Vincia. What is the average area that a drone can cover? It is based on how much we set.
It depends on two things, not only on the what we said, it depends upon the battery life of the drone. So normal quadcopter drones fly only 20 to 30 minutes duration, so that can't scan a large area. But for scanning large areas, the second video which I've shown, that fixed wing drones only.
Because they're asked, is the drone chargeable or runs by battery, like that they're asked. Same Dimble.
Battery only most of the drones used, madam. Nowadays, this electric chargeable drones are also there, but battery powered drones only we use.
Lithium, sir, thank
battery drones.
Okay, sir. Next from question from Ms. Indumati. What are the skill set required for students to shine in drone technology? And what are the best drone platform for research? Same question she has asked.
Yeah, same. The same thing. They need to learn how to build a drone by themselves. So by that way only they'll understand every detail of how drone operates, from motors to sensors to gyroscopes in drone. And then they can go for vertical takeoff and landing drones and fixed wing drones. This on the hardware side, and the software side also, how to data. So some of tools like Pix4D, drone deploy, all these softwares are there. So that also they can learn from the software side.
Okay, sir. And many questions have come. We will post you, sir. Now I hand over the mic to Ms. Mahadevan to read the questions from YouTube. Over to Mahadevan, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir. I have picked a few technical questions from YouTube Live for you to answer it. First question is from Anjali Devi. The question is, if any thunderstorms comes, will drones can be able to fly?
No, sir. That is a limitation with the drones. Not only thunderstorm, even if there is a strong wind also, normal quadcopters will go away with the wind also. So that is a drawback with the drones. But this high altitude fixed wing drones and all can withstand this strong winds and thunderstorm to an extent. But that is a limitation with the current drone technology which we have. So if it's a huge rainfall or a thunderstorm, we should not fly the drones. That is the only solution we have.
Okay, sir. The next question is from Manish Sajin. The question is, the flight path, if something came in that path, does drone is able to modify its path?
Yeah, good question again. So flight path, normally once we set the flight path, it will go on that flight path only. If that drone has this detection, collision and avoidance thing in that particular drone, it will just avoid that obstacle and bypass that, and then it will come to that flight path and go. If that collision and avoidance thing is not there in the particular thing, it will hit that which is coming in front of them, and it will break off. Now, these are the only two options available.
Okay. The next question is from Pungudi Asitambi. The question is it economical for farmers?
Yeah, definitely economical for farmers. So the thing is, how we use... earlier we won't use tractors for ploughing the field. Now we are using tractors for ploughing many acres of land. A single tractor is being done. Same way, if there are 10 farmers owning small portion of land, for all those 10 farmers, one agricopter can spray in all the 10 farmers land. So the same concept of how tractors are used, same way agricopters can be used. So it is profitable and more also economical for farmers as well. So they need not buy the drone. So they can just rent it as they would rent tractors or other things. They use it in their field, agriculture field. Same way they can rent the agricultural drone for the particular hours to spray or spray that pesticide alone. That way it is useful.
Okay. The next question is, can airport radar detect drones?
No, radars cannot track drones. That is the biggest problem. Radars, radars can only track big missiles or big objects. Drones are very small things. And another issue with the radar is, radar sometimes, even if a bird flies, it might think it is a drone also. So, radars are not useful for detecting drones. So radars, no way radars can detect this small drones and that.
Okay. So the next question is, is there any problem between drones and power lines?
Drones and power lines. Power line, if the drone hits, that is the problem with the power line. But I don't think any other problem with the drones and power lines, sir. I don't think so, sir.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Next question is, what about challenges and limitations of virtual reality?
Challenges and limitations of virtual reality. So,
yes,
the challenges, whatever the challenge we have is, cost is the one of the hindrance for virtual reality. So, cost of virtual reality devices drastically coming down compared to 2 years or 3 years back. So, now more industries are using virtual reality. So limitation is the virtual reality device. You'll not be aware of what is going around you in your real world. So that is the limitation. And another limitation is you can't use that virtual reality device for a longer period of time. Say, for example, if you are using that, wearing that for 30 or 20 minutes time, you might feel eye irritation slightly. So that is also being research is going on to reduce the eye irritation. So these are the limitations which we have with virtual reality.
Next question is from Manish Sai. Does haptic gloves are used to fill the augmented reality objects, sir?
No, haptic gloves are mainly used for virtual reality only. Augmented reality, it is like you'll be interacting with the real world as well as with the virtual world in augmented reality. With virtual reality only, you'll not be aware of what is going around in real world. So at that point of time only, haptic will be used. So for virtual reality only, we'll be using haptic gloves.
Okay. One last question, sir. How it is applicable in military? Virtual reality.
Yeah, okay, very good question. Military, even last year, US Army has made a deal with Microsoft HoloLens, wherein they procured Microsoft HoloLens and they trained their US soldiers using the Microsoft HoloLens. For example, normally the soldiers get trained in using the arms and ammunitions on how to react in a warlike situation. Everything they do it manually, which is a huge waste of money and time consuming also. Same thing is simulated using the Microsoft HoloLens. So once the soldier wears that HoloLens device, he will be seeing that virtually the war environment, how that war environment will look like and how to react to that environment. So everything can be simulated and shown to him. So because of that, more money is saved, time is saved, and the soldier also able to get trained effectively with this virtual reality. This way of defense that can be used. Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Hello. Now, what have reached? Uma, 1 minute. One question have come from by posted by Harita. Can we hack drones?
Hacking drones is yes, it is possible, pretty much possible. So drones operate on this 2.4 gigahertz, most of the normal commercial drones. So using that bandwidth, we can hack the drones. Yeah, that is possible, madam.
Okay, thank you, sir. Over to Uma.
Thank you, sir. Now we have reached the end of the session. And Assistant Professor Mrs. Pavitra will give vote of thanks. Over to Pavitra.
Thank you, ma'am. I thank our management, our administrator, our principal for giving opportunity for hosting this webinar. I thank our vice principal, our convener, Dr. Nalini Joseph, for mentoring us and took us in the right path for the success of this webinar. It is a supreme art of the teacher to awaken joy in creative expression and knowledge. I extend my sincere thanks to our resource person, Mr. R. Vijayarajan, sir, for this highly informative session and awaken our creative thinking. I thank all the coordinators of this webinar and all the faculties of EC department for their extended help. I thank all the participants for your kind cooperation throughout the entire session. For feedback link, I have already shared the feedback link. So in both GoToMeeting and in YouTube chat box, kindly fill them to get your e-certificate. We can able to process your e-certificate batch by batch. So you will be getting your e-certificate within 2 to 3 days. And the feedback link will be available until the end of the session. Thank you, one and all.
Thanks, yeah, Pavitra. Thank you, sir. We are closing the
recording.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Participants,
kindly fill up the. Participants can kindly fill up the form and leave the meeting. Sir,
Just a minute, madam. Yeah, can I?
Hello.
Yeah, madam. Yeah.
Questions have come, sir. We will post all the questions to your mail.
Sure, madam.
Reply will be sent to the respective participants because people have asked some questions also. Whether this class cost are very high. And then how do drones and augmented reality work together?
Yeah, yeah, everything, all those questions.
So these questions can be answered. And what is the difference between AI and augmented reality? Very good questions they posted, sir.
Yeah,
15 more questions are there. I will post everything to you, sir. Your answers will be sent to the participants as when they send the certificate.
All the answers
will be posted to them. Thanks for the session, sir. It's a wonderful session. Many have commented on that. I think you also can view in the chat boxes.
Yeah, yeah, sure, madam. Definitely, definitely. Thank you, madam. Thank you for giving this opportunity. And thank participants for patiently listening and asking so many questions. Thank you. Thanks a lot, madam.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello, Uma. Uma, Pavitra, by YouTube, post panna solunga feedback form.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Posted, ma'am.
Ma'am, it's not visible, ma'am.
Pavitra,
நிறைய டெக்ஸ்ட் போட்டுட்டு இருக்கேன் பட் இட் இஸ் நாட் கோயிங் த்ரூ அண்ட் நவ் மகாதேவன் சார் ஹேவ் போஸ்டட் இட் அகைன்
ஓகே மேம் ஓகே தேங்க் யூ சார்
ஓகே ஓகே மேம்
கைண்ட்லி மியூட் த மைக் Pavitra ma'am. Hello.
Yes ma'am.
Ma'am, link open aale nare per feedback kudukranga enna paarenga. Kindly check the feedback.
Yes ma'am, adu
after
100 responses certificate will not be provided ma'am, but you can able to send the feedback. I mean you can able to type the feedback. That is the issue ma'am.
No, ask them to send the type it again. Okay.
Yes
ma'am,
ma'am
chat box okay. You reply them ma'am if please
yeah okay
reply
ma'am
in the chat box
yes ma'am
they are
okay. okay yes ma'am okay.
Hello Pavitra ma'am.
Ma'am
yeah. They need to submit
yes ma'am yeah. I'll just verify
the
and I'll come okay ma'am.
ஹலோ உமா, எவ்வளவு பேர் இருக்காங்க உமா? நான் 19 பேர் தான் இருக்காங்க, போயிட்டங்களா?
ஆமா மேம், 19 மெம்பர்ஸ் இருக்காங்க மேம்.
ஓகே, வெயிட் வெயிட் வெயிட்.
ஓகே
மேம். ஹலோ மேம்,
சொல்லுங்க சார். யூடியூப்ல லைவ் இருக்கா?
யூடியூப்ல பாஞ்சு இருக்காங்க மேம், 15 மேம்.
Okay, okay. I'm not closing the session. Wait, wait. We are waiting. We are waiting.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
ma'am. Shall I close the feedback link? More than 300 feedbacks are now filled actually.
300?
Yes.
Ma'am, call for ma'am.
Okay. Bye.
Pavitra ma'am? Feedback form delete aagudilla?
Yes ma'am, okay. Feedback form work aagudhu ma'am. So feedbacks are keep on increasing, adhanaala kekkuren. Time exhaust aayidcha ma'am, shall I close it or shall I wait for a few more minutes to close?
Hello ma'am?
Ma'am, yes ma'am.
Ma'am, feedback close pannirunga ma'am.
Ma'am, but okay, YouTube is not open.
Ma'am, ஒரு 5 minutes wait பண்ணலாம் ma'am.
Yes ma'am.
Pavitra, feedback form open ஆகுதுன்றாங்க.
YouTube 5 minutes open பண்ணுங்க. YouTubeல பண்ணின இருக்காங்களா? லேட்டா போஸ்ட் பண்ணோம்ல மாதேவன் சார் சொல்றாரு. 5 minutes இரு.
Not open ma'am னு கமெண்ட் செய்து ma'am. Not opening link, not open ma'am.
Sir, அது வந்து கடை சேட்ல வந்து ரிப்ளை பண்ணுவாங்க sir.
இல்ல மேம், இன்னும் இன்னொன்னு என்னன்னா, ஒன்ஸ் அவங்க சென்ட் பண்ணிட்டாங்க அப்படினா செகண்ட் டைம் ஓபன் ஆகாது சார். ப்ராக்ஸி பண்ணும்போது அது ஓபன் ஆகாது. அதனால அவங்க அகைன் நாட் ஓபனிங் சொன்னாங்க. நம்ம ஆல்டர்னேட் பின் கொடுக்கலாம் என்ன.
சரிங்க மேம்.
மகாதேவன், டெல் देम டு மெயில் டு us.
நம்ம அவங்க செக் பண்ணி சார்.
ஓகே மேம்.
மெயில் ஐடி போட்டு டெல் देम டு மெயில். ஒன்ஸ் தே ஃபில் தி ஃபீட்பேக் ஃபார்ம், தே கேனட் ஏபிள் டு ஓபன் இட் அகைன்.
ஓகே மேம்.
சார், செஷன் வந்து we'll send the mail separately சொல்லிருங்க சார்.
Okay ma'am.
Mail separately, then we'll send the feedback form சொல்லிருங்க.
Ma'am, still 9 people are watching ma'am.
Sir, அவங்க எல்லாம் கடைசி நேரத்துல வந்துட்டு feedback form fill up பண்ணுவாங்க சார்.
Okay.
நம்ம close பண்ணிடுவோம். அவங்க வேணும்னா நம்ம கிட்ட அனுப்பிட்டு அப்புறம் பார்த்துக்கலாம்.
Okay ma'am.
இதுவே நெட் சார் சொன்னார். Okay.
Okay ma'am.
உமா ma'am, அவங்கள லீவ் பண்ணிக்கலாம் ma'am.
Okay ma'am.
Thank you ma'am.
ஆமா.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, சதா இது ma'am.
ஆமா சார், வேண்டவங்க நமக்கு போடுறேன் சர்டிபிகேட்.
Yeah.
Okay ma'am. Okay.
If you want, they can mail us separately sir. I have given the mail ID also, so they can mail and
பண்ணி கேட்டுங்க சார், அப்புறம் டிக்கெட் அண்ட் சென்ட் இட். Okay. Ma'am, close பண்ணிரலாம். லீவ் பண்ணிரறேன்.
Thank you ma'am. Thank you ma'am.
Thank you ma'am.
Thank you ma'am.
Thank you ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.